Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Poland Daily History. We are here at the city of Lublin, one of the most historical and largest cities of all of Eastern Poland. Today, we are going to the Catholic University of Lublin, a bastion of the anti-communist movement during the time when Poland is in the grip of the Soviet Union. It was also the home to Karol Wojtyła, who would later on become Pope John Paul II. There, we will talk to a historian who specializes in 20th century history. In 1939, when World War II erupts, Lublin is hit as hard as all the rest of the Poland. And I was wondering if you can elaborate on how it looks like here in Lublin, especially when it comes to the German occupation and a little bit afterwards in 1944 during the Russian occupation.
W czasie II wojny światowej Lublin był okupowany wyłącznie przez Niemców. Armia Czerwona.
During the Second World War, Lublin was occupied only by the Germans. The Red Army didn't reach Lublin in 1939. However, Lublin suffered a lot from the very beginning, because Polish units from the west, be it from the Warsaw or Krakow areas, withdrew to the east through Lublin. Because of this, Lublin began being bombed from September 5th, 1939. Factories as well as residential homes were bombarded. Among others, what we call the Old City was heavily bombarded. As a result, civilians were killed here from the beginning. When the Germans took Lublin, persecution of the civilian population began immediately. Two groups suffered the most to begin with. That was the Polish intelligentsia, which already began to be executed in September 1939, and the Jewish population. By the end of 1939, the Germans marked local Jews with stars, as they did in the whole of Poland, and created a local ghetto. They closed off part of the town, surrounded it with barbed wire, cutting it off from the rest of the town, and shoved the Jewish population in there, while at the same time executing specifically chosen Jews from time to time. Lublin and the Lublin Voivodeship was an extremely important part of the German plans. At that time, Hitler and those surrounding him didn't know what to do with the Jews. At the end of 1939, they came up with a plan to create a settlement zone for Jews in the Lublin Voivodeship, a type of Great Jewish Reservation. They wanted to create it in the area to the east of Lublin, where Jews from all of occupied Europe were to be brought, and there, as a result of illness, malnourishment, and hard work, they were to die. But this plan did not come to fruition, and from the end of 1941 and the beginning of 1942, a different plan was implemented, a plan to exterminate the Jews. The headquarters of Operation Reinhard, the operation to kill all Polish Jews, was here in Lublin. The main architect of the final solution, Odilo Globocznik, also resided in Lublin. The Polish population was persecuted in a more selective manner. In 1940, under the AB Action, the operation to eliminate Polish intelligentsia, the first 1,000 Polish intellectuals were shot at Rury Jezuickie in Lublin and in many other parts of the town.
W Lublinie i w wielu punktach miasta rozstrzelano pierwsze 1,000 polskich inteligentów.
So the Holocaust is one of the more devastating events that was permeated throughout Europe, especially Poland, and especially in the Lublin region, we are close to one of the death camps known as Majdanek. I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit about the Holocaust and how it looked like specifically in this region.
Majdanek nie był obok Lublina. Majdanek to był obóz zbudowany w Lublinie.
Majdanek wasn't next to Lublin, it was a camp built in Lublin, it's a part of the town. So we have a situation where we have a factory of death right beside the houses of Lublin residents. It is hard to imagine, but that is exactly how it looked. Majdanek was the smallest of the death camps built by Odilo Globocznik in the Lublin Voivodeship. Sobibór and Bełżec, both 100 kilometers away from Lublin, were far more important and far bigger factories of death. Around 80,000 people died in Majdanek, so relatively little. Two-thirds were Jews, one-third were Poles and Soviet prisoners of war. Whereas the powerful factories of death like Sobibór and Bełżec each had 300 to 350,000 people die in them. These 350,000 people were murdered in under a year, and the average lifespan of a person in such a factory, from the point of arrival, was around 2 hours. People were killed within 2 hours, at the rate of around 5,000 per day. It was a horrific and cruel experience, and Lublin played the role of kind of an organizational base for this enormous crime. It's from Lublin that the Germans managed the factories of death and gathered together the assets taken from the Jews. This is where they sorted what they took and sent it off either to the German army or the Third Reich. At the same time, the Germans planned for the Lublin voivodeship to be the first bastion of Germanness in the East. That is why at the end of 1942, and it's something they developed further in 1943, they began to deport the population of Zamojszczyzna. In the space of a couple of months, over 100,000 Poles were deported and replaced with 23,000 German settlers, who were given the land and assets taken from the Poles. As a result, in this area around Zamość and Zamojszczyzna, there was a great partisan war, where the Polish underground opposed the Germans, the German settlement lords. This ultimately led to the suspension of settlement action.
Osadniczym, co ostatecznie doprowadziło do wstrzymania owej akcji osadniczej.
During the Second World War, the Germans used force to deport more than 100,000 Poles from the Lublin region in order to conduct its first attempt of colonizing an area in the Central Eastern Europe. Around 50,000 of the Poles were sent to forced labor camps in Germany. Next up, we will ask Professor Wnuk about the revenge actions of the Polish underground and the spiral of violence in eastern Poland.
So we know that the Germans wanted to establish like a little German state here in the Lublin region. And I was wondering, how did the Polish partisan wage war against them, and were there other victims? Did the violence spread? How did it affect the whole region and its people?
Musimy wrócić przede wszystkim do tak zwanego Ostplanu, czyli niemieckiego planu wschodniego, planu osadnictwa niemieckiego.
First and foremost, we must return to the Ostplan, the German plan for the East, the German settlement plan. German planners believed the entire area in the East, from the pre-war German border up to the Ural Mountains, should be a German area. They planned that within 30 years, through work, through the sterilization of women and men, by simply cutting these people out within 30 or 60 years tops, Slavs would no longer be around in the whole of Eastern Europe. The first area where this was attempted, as I already said, was Zamojszczyzna, and this is where the first German settlers were placed. Poland's response was to oppose these settlers, an operation aimed against armed Germans and also the civil population. So a spiral of murder and hatred began. At the same time, in 1943, the Ukrainian population living in Volhynia, in Galicia, and the east of the Lublin voivodeship began to be organized by Ukrainian nationalists, who wanted to build their own state, and the first big military operation aimed at the Polish population was the ethnic cleansing in Volhynia, which at the end of 1943 and the beginning of 1944 spilled over into the Lublin voivodeship. So the east of the Lublin voivodeship became a battlefield, a place of murder, a free-for-all. Poles killed Germans, Poles were killed by Germans and Ukrainians, Poles killed Ukrainians. It was a horrific time, and the Lublin voivodeship became hell on earth.
Było to straszliwy czas, a Lubelszczyzna stała się swego rodzaju piekłem na ziemi.
We know that there's a German concentration camp here at the city of Lublin, but then in 1944, when the Soviets rolled into Lublin, how did the Germans react to it? Like, how did they do anything to cover up their crimes, or did they just let it sit there?
Jeśli chodzi o dwa te najważniejsze obozy śmierci, czyli Sobibór i Bełżec,
When it comes to the two most important death camps, Sobibor and Belzec, at the end of 1943, when the European Jewish population had practically been killed off, the camps stopped being important, so the Germans went ahead with an operation to extract the bodies which had not been burned, then burning and grinding them up before burying them. It was a special operation to hide their crimes. This happened in Belzec and Treblinka. The camps were completely abolished, plowed and given to local farmers as farmlands. In the case of Belzec, it was a Ukrainian farmer. In the case of Sobibor, a forest was planted in order to completely hide what had happened. Lublin was freed so quickly, the Soviet offensive was so fast that they didn't have time to hide the evidence of the crimes there. So when Majdanek was emancipated, all the barracks stood still, and for the first time, Soviet soldiers saw what a concentration camp was. The Germans, of course, tried to kill off all the prisoners up until the last moment. Because they could not burn the bodies in crematories fast enough, they burnt them in the open air. A similar operation was conducted against mainly Polish prisoners at the castle in Lublin, where, because they couldn't hide their crimes, they just murdered all the prisoners in their cells the day before their withdrawal. They closed the cells and fled. The bodies lay there for 3 hot July days. If I remember correctly, around 800 prisoners were killed in this way in Majdanek. The horror of the German occupation lasted until practically the last day the Germans were present on this land.
Krótko mówiąc, horror niemieckiej okupacji trwał praktycznie do ostatniego dnia obecności Niemców na tej ziemi.
As we have seen today, Lublin has a very long, yet at times dramatic history. But places such as the Catholic University of Lublin sufficiently demonstrated the city spirit and their love for freedom. I'm your host, Benjamin Lee. I'll see you next time on Poland Daily History.